Epilogue. Home. Jeff Bridges had more to say in memory of actor and comedian Robin Williams, all triggered by an unlikely source, an appearance by New York City legend Radio Man, who ran into Williams during the filming of The Fisher King and reportedly coached him on his performance as a homeless person. Shortly after hearing of Robin's death while attending the Giver premiere, Bridges spotted Radio Man outside the after party for this film at the Central Park Boathouse. And Jeff Bridges is quoted as saying, "Is that Robin? Is that his ghost? No, it's Radio Man." And it brought back all these wonderful feelings of what an amazing time we had together here in New York shooting The Fisher King. And so we embraced, Radio Man and I, and I felt Robin's spirit as I'm feeling it here now in this room with us. What a gift he was to all of us. That's a quote from an article about the premiere of the film The Giver. Did you hear? Mrs. Doubtfire has died. The news that Robin Williams, the actor and comedian, had taken his own life at the age of 63 came via the above sentence while I was attending a film premiere of The Giver in New York City. As the word spread through the theater like wildfire, a number of people on the red carpet paused to reflect on his influence in their lives. Jeff Bridges wept openly and recalled how much he loved Robin, how much he'd influenced and enlivened his life. I first met Robin Williams' doppelganger on the set of the film Salt, which I worked on at the behest of my friend, the Australian film director, Philip Noyce. As Jeff Bridges mentioned above, Radio Man would appear wherever a set is in New York City as if by magic. He rides a bike with a radio strapped to the handlebars, and it's uncanny. He does really look like Robin. His voice, his smile. At first, I thought it was actually Robin pretending to be a homeless fellow. But then I remembered The Fisher King and realized here was the living embodiment of a role that Robin had played on screen, as if the creation of Robin's role had jumped off the screen and sprung to life. There are a number of things about Robin's passing that remind me of this research. The quote from his film, August Rush, being one of them. Quote, "You know what music is? God's little reminder that there's something else besides us in this universe. Harmonic connection between all living beings, everywhere, even the stars." As accolades poured in around the planet, I reflected on my own brief exposure to Robin. It was over dinner at a friend's house, and I was at a table with him and Charles Grodin. Robin was both gracious and friendly, and for some reason took the opportunity for polite chatting rather than flights of fancy. I didn't get a chance to tell him that I'd also been in the Harvey Lembeck Comedy Workshop for a number of years, as he had been, and had heard of his legendary performances in the class, that I too was a huge fan of Jonathan Winters, and I had the good fortune to attend a number of lunches with him at his favorite table at Musso and Frank's restaurant in Hollywood, that I had once asked Jonathan a question about his father and how that had sent him into a flight of fancy that took us to the Revolutionary War, fighting with Indians, and then realizing we were on the wrong side, but being aware of his difficulties with his Marine Corps dad, I knew that the reason we'd gone down this path was because his father was a trigger for him in some ways, that to avoid discussing something of great pain for him, he went into a place of great comedy. So at the end of this 45 minutes of amazing improvisation, I was able to pick up the thread of the question. "So, I take it you don't want to discuss your dad?" To which Jonathan Winters roared with laughter. Robin Williams knew how to roar with laughter. David Letterman ran a tribute to him the other day where Robin was frequently throwing his head back, roaring like a lion with laughter. David had said something that allowed Robin to release that laugh. A kick back of the head, chin pointed skyward, his legs stretched out. He was literally roaring. Just a quick note about depression. If you know someone who's suffering from it, I encourage them to look into the scientific research on meditation. Professor Richard Davidson's work at the University of Wisconsin has proven that meditation can alleviate or cure depression. In his monumental study, meditation can actually change the shape of the amygdala where depression exists in the brain. So depression is not an ailment without a cure. It's a clarion call that something is wrong. It's worth checking into these alternative methods as a combination of modalities, maybe what is required. And by the way, that's what helped David Bennett recover from cancer in the chapter Voyage of Purpose. But the good news is, Robin Williams is not dead. Like Elvis, he's just left the building. Suicide's a tricky subject. I can only weigh in on the Flipside research. We all choose to come to the planet to learn and teach lessons. We are not here by mistake or happenstance. Each person has their own path and journey. Each has a myriad of reasons how they choose to experience the journey here or for exiting the stage when they do. Once we wrap our minds around the fact that we don't die, or in this case, can't die, then the matter of our leaving the stage is one of logistics. Do we judge an entire life or performance on how an actor leaves the stage? Yes, I love the play. The first and second act were great, but you tripped as you came off stage, and that I cannot forgive. Two thumbs way down. We tend to write reviews on how an actor exits. Quote, a belt, a plastic bag, a box of pills, and ignore those who are checking themselves out with each cigarette, each shot of whiskey, each time they drink and drive and or text. Are they any less guilty of choosing the manner of their death than others just because it happens to be a slow, lingering exit? And we applaud those who manage to stay on stage until their last breath, surrounded by loved ones, whether it's Betty McCall or the world's oldest man, and we wag our fingers at deaths we don't applaud, whether Robin or a child in a wedding party taken out by a drone. We've all got a myriad of exits and entrances behind us and ahead of us. Suffice to say, it's up to us how we manage them. Again, this research shows that we don't die. That each life is a sacred, precious choice that we come here to learn and teach and love for many reasons. And the manner of our passing has roots in our own path and journey. Robin is okay. He's fine. He hasn't gone anywhere. He's just not here or visible to us. And that's a damn shame because he lit up the stage, made the entire planet laugh, and there's nothing more healing than laughter. I was in a post office in Manhattan the day he died, waiting in a long line. When I got to the front, the tired postal employee said with exasperation, "Finally, the last customer. I'm going to lunch." I smiled and asked, "So, what's for lunch?" She looked at me to see if I was trying to bait her, and then softened when she saw my face on the book I was mailing. Someone had come to hear me speak at Tibet House in Manhattan about Flipside and asked me to send a copy of the book, which has my mug on the back cover. "What's it about?" she asked. I said, "It's about what thousands have said under deep hypnosis about the afterlife." She looked at me. "I've been crying all morning since I heard the news that Robin Williams died." I said, "Well, these people say that he hasn't died. He's just not here. It's like he got off stage too early. But he still exists, just as our love for him will always exist." She reached over the counter with her rubber-gloved hand and held mine. Tears welled in her eyes. "You have no idea how much I needed to hear that today. Thank you." Later, I was at a bodega helping an owner speak to a family from Spain in broken Spanish. Afterwards, I asked the owner, where was he from? He said, Nepal. Joking, I said, "My son's from Nepal." I told him a quick story of our son, RJ, remembering life as a monk in Nepal, as we recounted earlier, and shared a few of the stories which seemed to verify RJ's proclamation. The owner asked if he could see a picture of him. I showed him a picture of our 9-year-old smiling son. Shopkeeper closed his eyes, said a prayer, moved his hand from his heart to his lips to his forehead. Then he looked at the photo and said, "You can see it in his face. Serenity." And then I realized the man was weeping, tears rolling down his cheeks. He wiped his tears and said, "Thank you." That was very powerful. So then I told him the story, the same story RJ had told us, how when I sat him down to tell him his grandmother was going to pass away, that the next time he saw her, she'd look different. How he'd picked up a bottle of water and said, "Spirit is like water. Watch." And how he'd stomped on it until the bottle was crushed and broken, then picked it up and showed it to us. The bottle demolished, but the cap still on. "You see, Dad? The water's okay." It bears repeating. Our bodies may get crushed and old and broken. We may do things to them and check out early. But the spirit, like water, will always be okay. Like Robin Williams, our loved ones, no matter how or when they leave the planet, will always be okay. After all, they've just gone home. In most of the between life sessions I've filmed, people report at the end of their previous lifetime, they want to go home. I said it during my own first between life experience when I saw myself as an American Indian standing on the edge of a river about to end my life. Not entirely unlike Jimmy Stewart on the bridge in It's a Wonderful Life. I said, my life is a shell. I just want to go home. But I didn't have an angel Clarence who could jump into the river and save me. No one to show me all the people that I had affected or influenced in that lifetime. And after I jumped in, it seemed like I flew back home. If there's a common theme in this research, it's that when we're here on the planet, we're not home. We're someplace else. According to these many accounts, we've chosen to be here. And it takes courage to be here. We've signed up to be here. We've earned the right to be here. We signed up for lifetimes that may seem difficult while we're living them, but back home, we knew it was the right thing to do. I've had 4 between-life sessions now, during which it always felt like I had returned home. I saw my spirit guide, saw my friend, spoke to and laughed with my old friend Luana as well. I got to see and hear my father's voice again and heard direct messages from my soul group. They were all home. Some find it useful to consider our journey away from home as a theatrical piece. Actors going on stage, choosing their roles, costumes, props, performing right at night after night, improvising, jumping off stage too early at times, but basically investing their hearts and souls into their story for the benefit of others. Here's a famous passage how Will Shakespeare put his version of this journey of souls. All the world's a stage and all the men and women merely players. They have their exits and their entrances. And one man in his time plays many parts, his act being in 7 stages. At first, he's the infant, mewling and puking in the nurse's arms. Then the whining schoolboy with his satchel and shining morning face, creeping like a snail, unwilling to school. And then the lover, sighing like a furnace, with a woeful ballad made to his mistress's eyebrow. Then a soldier, full of strange oaths and bearded like the leopard, jealous in honor, sudden and quick in quarrel, seeking the bubble of reputation, even in the cannon's mouth. And then the justice, in fair round belly, with good capon lined, with eyes severe, and a beard of formal cut, full of wise saws and modern instances, and so he plays his part. The 6th age shifts us into the lean, with slippered pantaloons, spectacles on his nose and a pouch on his side, his hosiery well saved, too wide for his shrunken torso, and his big manly voice has turned again into a childish treble, with pipes and whistles for its sound. The last scene that ends this strange eventful history is the 2nd childishness, and then mere oblivion. Sans teeth, sans eyes, sans taste, sans everything. Each one of these metaphors, from crying infant to whining schoolboy to ardent lover, loyal soldier, wise sage, then older shrunken man, and finally back to childish elder, aptly captures the various roles we play on Earth as well. Each stage of life comes with its own dialogue, props, and storyline. We do our best to fulfill our sacred promises to the stage manager. Some feel this metaphor is incomplete because the idea of being part of a play or a stage event makes it seem like life is less important than it is. Perhaps life university is a more apt metaphor. We all sign up for classes. We all learn at our own pace and our own ability during each life. And if we fail a particular class, we get to try it again. We're all in the same university, a word derived from universe. So perhaps it resonates more to realize we're all in this school together. We all choose to be here. We are all here for a reason. But beyond that, what have we learned in It's a Wonderful Afterlife? The consciousness is not necessarily created by the brain, because there's sufficient scientific evidence that shows people can have conscious memories, thoughts, ideas, when there's no blood in their brains. While the brain does record, that's not the right word, probably more like filters, human experiences, it appears to not be the source of consciousness. Or as Nikola Tesla, the scientist, said, my brain is only a receiver. In the universe, there is a core from which we obtain knowledge, strength, and inspiration. I have not penetrated into the secrets of this core, but I know that it exists. We also heard from people who have had near-death experiences, having similar journeys to those described in the Between Life therapy sessions. Dr. Helen Wamba did her own form of research about hypnosis as Michael Newton and got the same results. People claim to exist prior to coming here. Experience is how we learn everything, according to this research. Whether as a healer, a teacher, an artist, a mathematician, everything is energy. And it requires our being able to experience that energy in order for us to master it. Which reminds me of when we were trying to find the right preschool for our son. I spent a few weeks tracking down what I thought was the right preschool near our place in Santa Monica. We drove by the school with his older sister Olivia in tow. She was about 5 at the time. The following morning, Olivia said she had a dream and announced, "That's not the right school that RJ goes to." Chagrined, I looked at my wife, Sherry. Most parents, upon hearing their children describe some kind of dream, would dismiss it. But as you can tell, not in Shea Martini. Where is the school that he's supposed to go to?" I asked. Olivia said, "I don't know. But it's not the one you showed me. He goes to a school not far from my school, and his teacher has long blonde hair." Well, that would be just about every preschool in Santa Monica, but since the school we signed him up for was beginning in a few days, we decided to take Olivia for a drive and see what we might find. We started at her present school and began driving in concentric circles away from her school. After about 5 minutes, she said, "There, that's it." She pointed to a small church in Santa Monica. I was not aware they had a preschool, but I called them. Church told me they didn't have a preschool, but there was one next door. Principal said they had normally had a long waiting list, but a student had dropped out unexpectedly that very morning. She had a question for me. "Is your child a boy or a girl?" I told her a boy. She said, "Well, we try to keep a mix of boys and girls, and we do have an opening for a boy. Is he ready to join the school this coming week?" I said he was. And then I said, "Can I ask you an odd question? What color is your hair?" She paused a moment and said, "It's blonde. Why?" As it turned out, it was one of RJ's teachers who had the long blonde hair, just as Olivia predicted, and he developed a bit of a crush on her. Now, if we can just get Olivia to pick lottery numbers. Frank Capra wrote It's a Wonderful Life after having a profound spiritual experience. A bald, faceless man chewed him out for pretending to be ill when he had a purpose in his life, to make people laugh. He owed it to the planet to get out of bed and do what he was born to do. Perhaps we should all follow suit. We've come to the end of the first volume of It's a Wonderful Afterlife. If you've come this far, you know there's more adventures that lie ahead in Volume 2. All you need to do is turn the record over, or in this case, click on the audio file.